hour of 10:15 having arrived, we will call the House Tax Committee to order. We're not quite at a quorum yet. When we do have a quorum, we'll take care of a few administrative items. We're very pleased to have House Files 301 and 300 before us today. If Chairman Urdahl could come before the committee, we will start and we'll officially call the meeting to order when we have a quorum. And members, Ms. Dalton, I believe that House File 301 and 300 are exactly the same.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, they accomplish exactly the same thing. They're just stylistically a little different.
Okay, Chairman Urdahl, welcome to committee. Which one would you like to work off of?
301, please.
301. So members, if you take out 301, we will not be looking at 300 then. They're both Urdahl bills. Anytime I can not look at an Urdahl bill. I'd be more than happy to look at all of them and give them a fair and thorough discussion as we do.
Fair and balanced.
If you could, fair and balanced. If you could please identify yourself for the record and present your bill, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Representative Dean Urdahl, and House File 301 is thus.
Okay, thank you, Representative Urdahl. We do have a quorum. I'll officially call a House Tax Committee meeting to order. Representative Schultz moves the minutes of January 19th, 2017. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion prevails. I will move House File 301. Chair Urdahl.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In 2006, as part of the Twin Stadium bill, a provision was added exempting the sales tax on high school league tickets. As part of the exemption, the legislature required the monies be returned to schools in the form of grants and assistance in the payment of participation fees. This was an effective way to deliver funds to our athletic departments and parents. Approximately $850,000 per year was spent reducing the cost of participation fees, as well as providing training for coaches, equipment, defibrillators, late activity buses, and many other activities. This exemption expired on June 30th, 2015. This bill will reinstate the exemption and make it permanent. And I have a testifier.
Okay, does it make it retroactive or just permanent from this point on?
From this point on, I believe.
Okay. Is there anyone, I know you got, other than Chairman Urdahl's testifier, is there anyone in the audience who wish to testify on behalf of this bill or with concerns thereof? That means that we keep them short. Or somebody want to testify with concerns? The department, of course. That's a given. We always listen to the department. Well, we always let them testify. Okay, so with that, please bring your first witness up. Please state your name and who you represent for the record, please, sir.
Troy Urdahl.
Are you related to the chairman?
He's my father.
Oh, only by him being your father. Okay. Okay, so welcome to the committee, sir, if you could please present your testimony.
Good morning, Chair Davids and committee members. My name is Troy Urdahl. I've been the activities director at St. Anthony Village High School for the last 12 years. I'm also the vice president of the Minnesota State High School League's board of directors and past president of the Minnesota State High School Coaches Association.
Welcome, committee, sir.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak to you this morning about the sales tax attributed to the High School League tournament sales and the High School League's foundation. After providing a brief history of this sales tax exemption, I'd like to spend a couple minutes talking about the significant benefits this provision allows for our state schools. And I also recognize there are enough long-winded Urdahls in this building, so I'll keep my remarks brief today.
I wasn't going to say that.
Next bill.
Until sunsetting in July 2015, an exemption on ticket sales for High School League and its regions had been in place since 2006 for sales tax. The monies that would be paid in sales tax were instead transferred to a foundation whose purpose is to give money back to our state's schools. Since 2008, almost $6.2 million have been given back to Minnesota schools. These funds are directed into two major categories. First, to assist with funding programs for students who are on free and reduced lunch, and second, to support our member schools and participation of our students. This support has come in many forms. Examples include purchasing AEDs for school buildings and funding training opportunities for coaches, advisors, and our students. In the school district I work for, the St. Anthony Brighton School District, approximately 23% of our high school students receive free or reduced lunch. We understand that money can be a barrier to participation, and we work hard to make sure every student who wishes to participate is able to do so. To participate in a sport at St. Anthony Village High School, the registration fee is around $150. If you receive free or reduced lunch, the participation fee is between $20 and $30. In part, the Minnesota State High School League Foundation dollars have helped make these significantly reduced rates possible for our students. Additionally, the Minnesota State High School League Foundation funding has allowed our school and hundreds of other schools the opportunity to provide valuable professional development opportunities for our coaches and advisors, in addition to important leadership training experiences for our students. Thankfully, you never have to work in a place where there's much disagreement. Sorry. Believe it or not, I get my humor from my father. Believe it or not, sometimes in education, it can be difficult to get different groups of people to agree. I'm very happy to report that's not the case for this provision. The Athletic Directors Association, Secondary Principals Association, Metropolitan School Districts, and the Minnesota School Board Association are all in support of this bill. Chair Davids, I'd be happy to answer any questions that you or your committee might have. And thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Let's see. Dr. Troy Urdahl, I'm sorry I missed that. Mr. Urdahl, questions from committee members for Mr. Urdahl. Chair Carlson.
Yeah, just a question. I'm trying to figure out what the difference here is between ticket and admission exemption. They almost seem interchangeable to me. What's the reasoning for having ticket and admissions? Wouldn't admissions simply cover it? Not a big issue. I'm just curious what the difference here is.
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, Representative Carlson, it's just traditionally how it's been stated, and changing the law after a number of years often leads to questions about what do you mean by changing the law? Why did you change it? So we just kept with the same tickets and admission language that had existed since 2006.
Mr. Chair, the only reason I mentioned it, it seems to be one and the same. I mean, not anything to hold progress of the bill up, but I was just curious if it had a meaning one way or the other. Thank you.
Chairman Urdahl, any thoughts?
No, thank you very much. I think regarding Representative Carlson's question, it's just paying for admission, whatever it is, whatever form it takes. But otherwise, I appreciate your support of this bill. And Chair Davids, you did disappoint me with one thing.
Just one?
You didn't ask what the mascot was at St. Anthony Village High School.
It's Litchfield Dragons.
Well, that's true. And the St. Anthony...
Moorhead Spuds.
St. Anthony Huskies.
Huskies.
Maryland Huskies.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. I'll never forget it again. Huskies. Okay, wonderful. Any other questions for Dr. Urdahl? Representative Dabney.
Mr. Chair, not a question, just an opportunity to make a statement. First of all, nice baseball fields.
Thank you.
Really nice baseball facility up there. But
the baseball coach, by the way.
And a good team, is from what I understand.
Let's
in fact, you've gone
order.
To
Let's
you've gone to
order here. Representative Dabney.
You've gone to state recently, haven't you? With your baseball team?
Yeah, we've had the opportunity to participate at states a number of times and won state championships in 2006 and 2008.
So there you have it.
2008, that's quite a while ago.
It is. It's been noted.
What you been doing lately?
Not winning state.
Chairman Dabney.
Let me ask then a second question to Dr. Urdahl. Do you know what has happened to the free and reduced price lunch count percentage of students, for those of you who don't speak English, or don't, excuse me, speak English but not education, free and reduced price lunch count of students between 2008 and 2016 in your district?
In my district, absolutely. Chair Davids, representative. In our school district, I began working in the St. Anthony New Brighton School District in 2002, and our free and reduced lunch count was somewhere around 7-8%. And so since 2002 until present, it's gone up 15%+ in terms of our count of free and reduced lunch students.
Chairman Dabney.
Thank you, Dr. Urdahl. It just hard putting doctor in front of Urdahl. Do you have that problem, Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
But I...
That's what it says here, though.
Yeah, I know. I'm believing you. Don't misunderstand. it's alternative universe, not alternative facts. But my appreciation for Representative Urdahl's bill is that we talk a lot in education about the achievement gap in terms of academic achievement. But as I look around the state, what I see is a opportunity gap in extracurricular opportunities for kids. And lower income kids don't have the same opportunities, they don't have the same access to facilities, they don't have the same ability to access club sports and summer camps and all of these things that kids in wealthier suburbs are able to do. It was when I dropped my daughter off at Minneapolis South High School for their homecoming game. Now, that has to be a day game. It has to be an afternoon game because South just cannot afford lights for their football field. And I dropped her off, and I came around the corner. They were playing Eden Prairie that day. And as I drove away, there was the semi for the Eden Prairie marching band. So a high school can't afford lights for its football field, but another one can afford a semi for its marching band. And I would argue that the gap in opportunities for extracurriculars, tied often to increasing poverty amongst our students, whether that extracurricular is the baseball team, or the debate team, or the robotics team, or the theater program, or whatever it is, correlates also to the achievement gap. We need kids to be engaged. Giving them opportunities to play sports is one way to do it, and this bill helps support that. In Minneapolis, 98.3% of the high school athletes graduate from school. It pays. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Dabney. I also have on the list, any other questions for Mr. Urdahl, Representative, or Chair Detmer?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I'm just looking at the fund impact here, and it says here, the proposed law, maybe there's something other in the law that's makes it clear, but the bill would exempt admissions to events and activities sponsored by the Minnesota State High School League. We're not exempting the cost of tickets.
Chair Davis, Mr. Representative Detmer, this is for sales tax. Okay. The exemption is for sales tax on tickets sold.
It just didn't say that on here.
Chair Detmer?
Thank you.
Okay. Other questions for Mr. Urdahl? Okay, with that, we'll go to, I believe I have Mr. Aronson and Ms. Kelleher, but are you resources? Do you want,
just resources, Mr. Chair.
Resources in support of the Urdahl legislation. Okay. And members, this is an issue that has been very, very bipartisan. I think Representative Marquardt, at some point you had carried a bill. Others of us have. What happened in conference committee last year was it was there, and in the whole scheme of things, when we wrapped the bill up, we didn't even think of it. I shouldn't say that, but nothing personal, Dr. Urdahl, but we missed it, and I don't think we'll miss it again. Chair Carlson.
You know, as most of you know, I'm a retired teacher, but I also did some coaching for sports through the years. But just as a follow-up to what Representative Dabney was saying, I remember one year when I coached the cross-country team at Henry High School in North Minneapolis, and we had the inductions into the National Honor Society. And I looked up there, and there was basically my cross-country team. So it does have a very, of course, co-curricular activities, whatever they may be, do have a very positive impact on a lot of students.
I see no more questions. Representative Hertas.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Something that just occurred to me with regard to the Minnesota State High School League. Does the High School League also cover the types of tickets or purchases for admission to anything the school would sponsor with regard to arts or theater or anything like that?
Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, Representative Hertas, to the extent that the Minnesota State High School League does like statewide debate tournaments and things like that, all of that is covered in this as well.
Okay.
School admission, admissions to school-sponsored events, which also includes theater and debate and things like that, are covered under the general sales tax exemption for school admissions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We seem to get preoccupied with sports all the time, so I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions for the Urdahl younger? Much younger? Okay, with that, we'll go to the department.
But this does say,
Mr. Chairman,
promote participation.
Mr. Chairman, if I could point out that Representative Detmer was also the teacher of my son's wife.
We'll talk later. If you could get a chair for Mr. Cummings, please.
You're trying to complicate this.
Yeah, Mr. Urdahl, I think we're done on your testimony. If anybody has questions, they can talk to you later here. Welcome to the committee. Do you have any comments on the bill that everybody's going to vote for?
Good morning, Mr. Chair, Representative Urdahl, and members. For the record, my name is Paul Cummings, and I'm the Tax Policy Manager at the Minnesota Department of Revenue.
Welcome to the committee, sir.
I did reach out to Representative Urdahl's office yesterday and wanted to say a lesser-known fact. My brother walked in parades for Representative Urdahl way back when. My folks live out by Litchfield. They live in Litchfield now, but we're from the same town, Grove City, so... Lesser known fact.
What are your Thanksgivings like?
They are spirited.
but yet delightful. Mr. Cummings.
We thank Representative Urdahl for bringing this bill forward. Governor Dayton and Lieutenant Governor Smith supports and has recommended in their budget restoring the exemption on admissions from sales tax to postseason games, events, activities sponsored by the Minnesota State High School League to fund its scholarship program. These bills and the governor's proposal provides for an annual fund transfer of the sales tax savings to a nonprofit charitable foundation that promoted high school extracurricular activities. This fund has provided transformational experiences for young men and women from across the state, and we appreciate Representative Urdahl, his co-sponsors, and your work, Mr. Chair, in restoring this important provision. The governor's proposal provides a five-year sunset on this exemption. If this bill moves through the process, Mr. Chair, the Department of Revenue, the governor, and Lieutenant Governor looks forward to working with you, Representative Urdahl, and staff. We thank you for the opportunity to be a resource today.
Mr. Cummings, how different is the governor's proposal from House File 301? Are they very similar? Ms. Dalton?
Mr. Chair, I have not seen the language for the governor's proposal, but I am assuming the only difference would be what Mr. Cummings stated, which is that it has a five-year sunset.
And 301 does not?
Mr. Chair, that's correct. 301 and 300 are both permanent exemptions.
Okay. Questions for Mr. Cummings from the department? Okay, thank you very much, sir. With that, I will renew my motion that... House File 301 be laid over for possible inclusion in the remarkable omnibus tax bill. So, members, if you would please remove 300 from your folders, we will now go to item next will be a McDonald bill, House File 349. Are there amendments on that? Nope. Vice Chair McDonald moves House File 349 to your bill. Representative McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow committee members. My bill basically repeals the tax on digital downloads that was enacted in 2013. In an attempt to pump up tax revenues, this tax was imposed, and at this point, with revenues estimated in the surpluses for not only 16-17 but 18-19. I see this as a unnecessary tax, and therefore offer this legislation to ensure that our residents can keep more of their money in their own pockets and not in the government's coffers. I stand for questions, Mr. Chairman.
Pretty straightforward. First of all, is there anyone from the audience who wishes to testify on behalf of the bill? Anybody with concerns? Questions for members? Chair Marquardt.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and maybe... House research could answer, what are we talking about exactly? And I remember this a couple years ago, but you know, CDs, music, and that, downloads. I mean, just a quick little synopsis on what all is included with this.
Ms. Dalton.
Mr. Chair, Representative Barcourt, you pretty much covered a lot of them. The one you haven't covered is e-greeting cards. But it's basically any audio-visual or audio-visual downloads. It also covers e-books and e-greeting cards. As I note in the summary, because of some other language that exists in our statute, just exempting, removing all the definitions of digital goods won't necessarily exempt all of these items. Some of them may remain taxable under our definitions of pre-written computer software and under our definition of pay television service.
Chairman Markport.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Ms. Dalton, for that. And Mr. Chair, you and I used to go and buy records. Remember those days?
I still do, actually.
Oh,
they're back.
Yeah, they are back.
They, oh.
Mm-hmm. Not much of a choice for turntables, but.
We use them at trap records.
I don't know if some who.
Steppenwolf, the Guess Who.
And Mr. Chair, some might have bought the old 8-tracks, which were kind of not too long lived. But
I've got those too. My wife wants to throw them out, and I'm thinking, how could you?
The concern I have, Mr. Chair and Representative McDonald's on this is your brick and mortar stores that sell books and sell CDs and the music stores and so forth. And, you know, the economy's changing. You know, there's no doubt about that. And I do think, and we've had this discussion in here in a larger scope on things more than just books and CDs and stuff like that, but it does place our downtown Main Street brick and mortar stores at a disadvantage, the new economy. And so, you know, what's your take on that? I mean, as I look at this, this hurts those downtown, you know, stores that are on your main streets. I mean, have you got some idea of what impact that might have on these folks?
Vice Chair McDonald.
Mr. Chair, thank you, Representative Markert. That's a great question. I happen to have a brick and mortar store downtown Delano. It's a 100-year-old building. I've been there for 30 years, so I'm one of them. It's a very legitimate concern. Some debate, including my thoughts and many others, would say that because a digital download, there is no necessity for the tax if you have a brick and mortar, meaning my property tax and my business that I have to tax my customers helps pay for police, fire, cleaning the roads, plowing the roads, security, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm hoping that when I have to pass that tax to my customers, that that tax that goes to my city or to my state helps the very safety issues in my community, that pays for those items that I suggested. In a digital download, there's nothing to secure that. There's no tangible item that tax is paying for public services. That's just police, fire protection, and maintenance of the streets and roads that allow a customer to get through a building.
Chair McDonald, or excuse me, Chair Mark.
Well, thank you, Representative McDonald. I'm concerned about the competitive nature. I think it puts the Main Street businesses further behind. I mean, I don't think this helps them. I think, if anything, it probably marginally hurts them. And that's my concern with this. And, you know, I know there's this whole idea of the internet sales and that type of thing. And I know we're kind of working towards that, and Ms. Dalton's making all sorts of efforts on that too. But hopefully, as we kind of look at all these things, we keep those Main Street businesses in mind. So, thank you, Chair.
Representative Loeffler.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. And that was my concern, because if I'm going to buy some music or I want to buy a book, if I can download it as an ebook and then save 7%, I mean, people are price conscious, then I'm less likely to go to the local independent bookstore or the chain bookstore. I mean, my city's just losing a big Barnes and Noble, and it's hard. And when you end up with a vacant storefront, you actually end up with less property value for the surrounding value properties if they're not able to, if we get less and less people going to Main Street to buy CDs or books or whatever. And so you actually end up with less of a property tax base and a contribution into that local economy we're trying to support. And to me, when we passed this, it really wasn't about money. It was about just making an equal playing field so that if you choose to download because you prefer reading on screens, you pay the same price as if you know, in terms of sales tax, as if you decide to go to the Main Street store because you like turning the pages of a page burner. You know, and so I think that it's, to me, the current law is fairer because it doesn't try and influence your choice of product. It says no matter what you choose as a customer, the state is going to treat you the same. And so I have some concerns about, you know, not only the loss of the revenue stream, but more importantly, you know, us as public officials influencing the private market in a way that I think right now is balanced.
Chair Deb.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And a question for Representative McDonald. One of the most important resources that the public provides the business community is a functioning court system. Much of the civil action in courts is businesses suing businesses. People don't pay you for the services you've provided. There's disputes over interpretation of a contract, things like that. When I go to the local bookstore and purchase something in or any local store, when I go to Electric Fetus and buy a CD, I pay sales tax on that purchase. And some of that sales tax helps to pay for the court system, which business can then access when they need. How does a tax-free digital download, contribute to the court system that that company may, in fact, access?
Vice Chair McDonald.
Thank you. Can you repeat that last part of your question?
Sure.
Chair Dabney?
Sure. When I purchase something from a local Main Street business and pay tax on that, some of that tax goes to support a court system that business may need or choose to access to deal with disputes. If I instead buy that same product online, including as a digital download, and don't pay any tax, as your proposal suggests, how does that purchase help pay for the court system that company might choose to or need to access?
Vice Chair McDonald.
Mr. Chair, Representative, it simply wouldn't. It wouldn't contribute, obviously.
Chair Dabney.
So, Representative McDonald, you talked about the property tax you pay as a business owner and the other taxes that your clients pay. I mean, actually, we know that is paid off of your business and how that goes to police and fire and transportation costs. But you left off, you know, a very important resource that the public provides the business community, which is the court system, which still needs to be paid for. And in fact, if you look at the backlogs that many courts face, you know, I believe Justice Gilday will give you a pretty good pitch for increased funding for the courts. And you're suggesting harming that funding, which in some respects harms the business community. It's just a concern I have with your bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Dabney. Representative Hertaus.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think sometimes we get a little deep in the weeds on some of these issues about what is and is not paying sales tax. You know, it's come to my attention that as internet sales have increased, most often when you do that, it has to be shipped. And what we're doing in a compensating way is we're creating quite an increase in jobs and opportunities for the shipping industry. From a competitive standpoint, and backing up, there certainly is revenue to be made off of the additional income and jobs that are in the shipping industry. But as a compensating factor in terms of competitiveness, you might, and at least it's true of small sales, I don't know that you can internet purchase or ship a car or a truck or something of that nature. You can certainly shop for it. You still have to take delivery in person and pay the tax. But with regard to the competitiveness, if you're buying a book online or whatever you're doing, the cost of shipping the book really from a competitive standpoint is offset by the shipping costs. So we're still picking up revenue at both sides of it, and I think that that needs to be considered. One last point, I guess if I traveled to the distant city of Delano and went to with my family to have my pictures digitally taken in a studio at a brick and mortar shop by a certain photographer, I would be paying sales tax for that service when I'm there. And I would hope that the delivery of that product, if shared digitally and sent to me via email rather than hard pictures for my own use, wouldn't be additionally or double taxed. So, you know, I would support that position of not taxing the digital download.
Thank you, Representative Hertaus. Representative Schultz.
I just want to make a clarification. It's not free to download items, movies, books, because someone is paying for the cost of broadband connection or internet service, either the state or the consumer. So we could think of a tax to help subsidize broadband expansion. Also, I think more public safety police are looking at cybersecurity, and you could think of using tax revenue to help fund cybersecurity for public safety.
Ms. Dalton, I've never downloaded anything. Is that true, what Representative Schultz said? Chair Erickson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Do we know from the Department of Revenue how much is generated through these kinds of sales? Do they keep that separate so we know if that's coming into our treasury or going some other place? And I'm curious.
I believe, Chair Erickson, if you look at the revenue note.
Oh, we have one?
I believe those figures would be there.
Sorry.
No, that's fine. That's okay. Fine. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay, Chair Carlson.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I was going to challenge a little bit the shipping costs, because retailers that are in the brick and mortar are going to be either repaying shipping costs directly or indirectly. You know, if you have a distribution center in Minnesota, they're probably employing warehouse personnel and drivers to ship the goods to the various brick and mortar stores. It may be a bit hidden in that sense. It's probably built typically into the price, but there are shipping costs. I don't know that that really is creating a level playing field by saying that the digital folks pay a shipping cost, because other costs are there as well, in my view.
Members, we just, as you know, at 11:15, the governor is going to be presenting his budget proposal. So I know some of you have to leave for that. So we could be wrapped up by then, but we're not going to cut off debate because of that. But some may want to go to that. So any other questions for Vice Chair McDonald on this bill? And again, anyone from the public wish to testify on behalf of the bill or with concerns? And let's go to the department.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, Vice Chair McDonald, and members. For the record, my name is Paul Cummings, and I'm the Tax Policy Manager at the Minnesota Department of Revenue. I just saw the note that Representative McDonald received, so I did reach out to him. And, Mr. Chair, I was eating at a cafe in downtown Delano. I was walking downtown, and I did see Representative McDonald's shop, but unfortunately he was not there. So next time, next time. This repeat,
did you have an appointment?
I did not. I, Mr. Chair, lessons for next time.
We live and learn.
This bill repeals the sales and use tax exemption that was imposed on digital goods. It will exempt sales and use tax on all digital goods. One of the important principles of taxation is to ensure that taxpayers are being treated equitably. If the state of Minnesota has decided that a product should be taxable, then it should be taxable regardless of how the product is transmitted, in digital form or in tangible form. Whether it is a compact disc or an iTunes or an MP3 shouldn't determine its taxability. Whether it's a hard copy book or a Kindle book shouldn't determine its taxability. whether it is a greeting card you buy at a stationery store or at an online store in digital form shouldn't determine its taxability. Small corner bookstores shouldn't have a competitive disadvantage from the giant providers of e-goods. This bill moves us out of step with neighboring states like South Dakota and the state that I know is important to you, Mr. Chair, to achieve tax parity with, Wisconsin.
And we will.
As other states move towards ensuring that products, whether digital or tangible, are being treated in the same for sales tax purposes, this bill would put us out of step with others. Governor Dayton and Lieutenant Governor Smith recommend creating a fair and consistent sales tax treatment of tangible products that are available in digital form. The governor tax bill provides greater consistency for the treatment of digital products to bring some clarity and consistency to this area of tax to ensure that all digital products that are available and taxable, that are available as taxable, tangible, personal products are in fact taxable. The Department of Revenue receives many questions from businesses trying to determine if an item is a digital product and if that digital product is then taxable. These questions indicate that there is confusion amongst taxpayers as to why something is taxable when it is sold as tangible personal property, but not when it was sold as a digital product. Examples of what is taxable in their tangible form that would be taxable in their digital form under the governor's proposals would include finished artwork, still photographs, copies of blueprints, and legal research documents. With changing technology, Mr. Chair and Vice Chair McDonald, more and more tangible products are being sold in a digital form. The governor's proposal provides consistency by making digital products taxable if they have a tangible counterpart that is taxable. That is true for many digital products currently, but not all. By updating Minnesota's law to reflect modern technology, we can ensure we are not creating incentives or disincentives to particular forms of product. If this bill, Mr. Chair, moves through the process, the Department of Revenue looks forward to working with you, Mr. Chair, Vice Chair McDonald, and staff, and we appreciate the opportunity to be a resource today.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings. Any questions for Mr. Cummings or Representative Metza?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just kind of, you know, along the lines of wrapping my head around this, I do think of a new technology with 3D printing. And would wonder, and it doesn't need to get answered today necessarily because it might take some digging into. You buy a digital copy of something, you print it, now you have a physical good sitting in your living room. Just food for thought.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Cummings or the author? Okay, thank you, members, for that discussion. So Representative McDonald moves that House File 349 be laid over for possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. With that, we will go.
Chair
Urdahl.
If anyone sees my cane, let me know.
That's not a very nice trick here. Mr. Cummings, did you take it?
Return his cane.
I saw it. It was leaning on that chair.
Yeah, I don't know.
Cheese and
glass.
They probably taxed it, I suppose.
Time to set them
all. Canes
are leaving the state.
Canes are leaving the state.
Migration to Wisconsin. Cane tax. Cane tax.
Medical device. Our crutches.
Okay.
You cane tax that.
Cheese and eyeglass.
I will move, Representative Petersburg will move House File 381. I see no amendments. Members, you have the revenue notice in the packet and the finely written bill summary. So with that being said, we now have House File 381 before us. Representative Petersburg, to your bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and this is a fine piece of legislation, I have to admit, here. It is something that we have heard in this committee over the last two bienniums, and I think it's important for us to hear it again. This bill here, first of all, I want to say that I did talk to our great resource, Mr. Cummings, and I know he has a few concerns that he will bring up about this. And I also want to thank he and his Department of Revenue for their optimism about the attendance here at Farm America, because I think last time the fiscal note was $8,000 and this year it's $11,000, so that's about a 30% growth. And we would all love to have that kind of growth at Farm America, so we appreciate that. But first of all, I would like to just make sure to help people understand that Farm America, oftentimes when we think about sales tax, we think of this as people will consider it an entertainment activity in entertainment group, but it's not. This legislature actually created it many years ago, and this is the charge that they were given: to preserve Minnesota's rural agricultural heritage and educate the public about rural history and how farms in Minnesota help provide food to the nation and the world. It really is designed to be an educational program and an educational activity, and it was created with oversight by the Historical Society and generated along with two other learning centers up in northern Minnesota. So we think that this really ought to be treated much more like educational nonprofits that are exempt from admissions. And so why the carve out here? I think because of the fact that the Farm America is really designed to try to bring people in, and the number of people that are staffed and employed there is really something that prohibits being able to generate a lot of overhead and over costs, and it's difficult to generate the sales tax computation and so forth for ticket sales. I also want to just clear up that this exemption is only for the admission. It's not for the retail sales that occur there. Farm America has always paid sales tax on that, collected sales tax from that. This is just trying to make it a little bit more equitable with other like situations that we have here in the state. With that, I will close what I have. I do have Warren Formal here to give a brief history, and two others, Bob Zelenka and Greg Bartz, that will be here as a resource if necessary. So with that, I'll turn it over to Mr. Formal, if that's okay, Chair.
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, is there anyone in the public wishes to testify on behalf of the bill? Anyone wish to testify with concerns? Now, Representative Petersburg, do you know what that means?
Yeah.
Okay. Please state your name and who you represent for the record, please.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Warren Formo. I'm the chairman of the board of directors of Farm America. And as Representative Forsberg, Petersburg mentioned, along with me this morning are Bob Zelenka, who preceded me as chair, and Greg Bartz, who is our current secretary of the board of directors. Obviously, we support this legislation. This is very important to us as an organization. I think both in terms of the financial impact, which to us is important, though it may be relatively small to the state of Minnesota, but also because of the validation and what it says about our purpose as an educational institution. And as has been said, our core mission is to educate people about the history and evolution of agriculture in our state. And so it's really quite that simple. So I guess with that, I would stop and see if there are any questions.
Okay, any questions for Mr. Formal? Okay, with that, we'll go to the department.
And while he's coming up, I would certainly...
Petersburg.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I would certainly invite everybody to come down and visit Farm America. It's right outside Wausau.
Welcome to committee, sir.
For the record, my name is Paul Cummings, and I'm the tax policy manager at the Minnesota Department of Revenue. Thank you for the opportunity to be a resource. I did talk to Representative Petersburg before the hearing. And Mr. Chair, I regret to say that I have not been to Farm America. So that is part of my future to-do list of Minnesota ventures.
Put it on your bucket list, Mr. Cummings.
Yes. So according to the Tax Research Division of the Department of Revenue, it is expected that Farm America is the only organization that would qualify for the exemption under this bill, Mr. Chair. In 2014, Farm America asked for amnesty in a bill similar to this bill. In the end, a formal amnesty was not enacted, but $25,000 was appropriated to Farm America in Chapter 312 of session law. This bill gives a sales tax exemption not offered to similar institutions. If action is taken on providing an exemption to this institution, other similar institutions may question whether this exemption would be unfair. I wanted to identify limitations of this exemption as well. This bill would not make prepared foods exempt from sales tax and use. It would also not exempt activities, registration fees for various events like a fun run or other types of activities. So thank you, Mr. Chair, for the opportunity to be a resource. We look forward to continuing the conversation on this bill and other important bills impacting Minnesotans.
Mr. Cummings, what is a similar institution?
Well, Mr. Chair, You know, whether there are activities going on like the Renaissance Festival or other sorts of things that provide learning opportunities but may also provide opportunities for recreation, you know, those sorts of places are taxable, the admissions to those. So what I'm trying to bring up is that trying to do one-off admissions to various events or institutions, if there's a larger question about what types of admissions should be exempt or taxable, that might be something to talk about at a higher level rather than going with each institution that comes in and thinks that their admissions should be exempt.
Thank you, Mr. Cummings. To questions from members, Representative Knobloch, Chairman Knobloch.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess this would be to Mr. Cummings or maybe Ms. Dalton. I'm just curious. I don't have a particular problem with this bill, but just in terms of sales taxation of nonprofits in general, I mean, I think the Renaissance Festival, I think, is a for-profit organization. Are there examples in law right now of other nonprofits that do have an exemption, and if so, what are they?
Ms. Dalton.
Mr. Chair, Representative Knobloch, there is one major exemption for nonprofit and government arts organizations, so that would cover art museums, theater, and dance performances. And it also has a specific exemption for the Minnesota Zoo. That's probably the only admissions and tickets exemption that exists for nonprofits. There are other exemptions for nonprofits that are really based on what they purchase. And then there's some fundraising exemptions as well for kind of one-off fundraising events.
Chair Knobloch?
Yeah, all right, I guess I just, and I've got to go to the other presentation. I know I had a bill last year, didn't cost anything more than this, I think, for a private BMX track in my district that was nonprofit, and some others had it. But this question comes up, and you know, I think it's a challenge to have some consistency, but I mean, a somewhat government type organization, which I see Farm America as kind of being as something that we kind of established a long time ago, certainly might fit into what we're doing right now.
Representative Metza.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and along, you know, those same lines, we have Discovery Center, or as we like to call it up north, Iron World, which has been a controversy in itself over the past 8 years. But they offer similar venues and have an admission ticket to come in and see. And I think our state's mining history is also important in my region. I think of iron and ag as closely related. We farm rocks and you farm everything else. And would just hope that, you know, if we're looking at it, that we would kind of try to keep track of all the groups that might qualify under this for their local regional history.
Representative Petersburg.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. And I think there was a difference between, because I think that one, as well as the one on lumber, I think already are exempt from their sales tax on things, and maybe Mr. Cumming can verify that, because they're directly related through the Historical Society, whereas one in Farm America was organized a slightly different, and yet through the Historical Society as well. And I think the Historical Society is also another one that is not required to pay sales tax on admissions, but I could be wrong on that part of it. And so they are kind of treated differently than the ones up north as well, and that's my understanding.
Could we clarify that, Ms. Dalton?
I'm sorry, I was interrupted. I'm not sure I heard the entire question, but I think...
Well, basically the question is, okay, Representative Metz in his district has an organization. Are they taxed or not? Or are they taxed the same way Farm America is currently, or where are we on that?
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, Farm America is treated the same as similar non-art museums. The Historical Society, non-art museums such as the Science Museum of Minnesota, Iron World, the Duluth Train Museum, all collect and remit sales tax on general admissions.
Yeah. Maybe we should build a coalition here or something.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Okay, questions for the author or the department? With that, I will, Representative Petersburg moves that House File 381 be laid over for possible inclusion in the omnibus tax bill. Anything else for the good of the order? If not, thank you, members, for your work. We'll see you tomorrow.
Yeah.
Good government all the time. We are adjourned.